Good afternoon and thank you for joining our webinar today. The webinar is brought to you by the Aerospace Division of the IMechE. If you've got any questions throughout this webinar, please can you just put it in the question box, and you can do that anytime throughout the webinar and they'll be answered at the end of this webinar. The webinar today is about automated fibre placement technologies for aerospace applications, and our presenter today is John Lewalski. He's a senior engineer who works at Electro Impact UK Limited. Electro Impact are a market leader in manufacturing technologies for the aerospace division, so they very much work with Airbus, Boeing and all the national space programs around the world. So I'll pass you over to John now, who will take you through the webinar today.
Thank you, Lavina, and thank you all for joining us for this webinar today. I'm going to start by introducing myself. I'm John Lewalski, and after graduating from Salford University, I started my career as an engineer for Electro Impact, and I've been here for the last 16 years. I've worked on multiple projects for Electro Impact within the aerospace industry, starting as a support engineer on the A380 program at Airbus, and then progressing to working in controls engineering on various projects, including Airbus's single aisle and A350 programs. After which I worked on some AFP projects, that's automated fibre placement, at the European Space Agency in Madrid and the National Composites Centre in Bristol. I think it's also beneficial to give you a very brief introduction to Electro Impact and what it is that we do. Electro Impact is a supplier of tooling and automation, primarily to the aerospace industry. And there are many Electro Impact manufactured installations all over the globe with many of the world's leading aerospace manufacturers. This slide just shows a few examples of what we do, and our clients include Airbus, Boeing and Embraer, along with some of the big players in the space industry, such as NASA, SpaceX, and the European Space Agency. The earlier products in our history all evolved from electromagnetic riveting technology, which is a process that involves cold forming rivets using an electromagnetic riveting tool in the assembly of aircraft structures, such as wing panels and fuselages. It's a technology that's been incorporated into a range of machines, such as the A380 LVC on the slide, which drills, rivets, and bolts wing panels, and is a technology more suited to traditional airframe designs using metallic components. But over the last 20 years, we've seen a significant shift to the use of composite materials, as the next few slides show. So over the next few slides, we're going to see the typical material composition of a range of aircraft from years gone by to some of the more recent aircraft we have flying today. Starting with the de Havilland Comet in the 1950s, this aircraft was composed of 100% aluminium alloy, which was both riveted and chemically bonded. In the 1970s, we had the Airbus A300, which was the first twin-engine wide-body aircraft in the world. And it would feature the first use of composite materials in any large European passenger aircraft with a composite makeup of 4%. The A320 saw a real increase in the use of composites in its manufacture, with 15% of the aircraft being made from composite material. The A380, with 22% makeup of composite materials, the slide shows a significant use of composites in the pressure bulkhead, so at the tail fin and the tail plane, which is composed of CFRP, which is carbon fiber reinforced plastic, and the upper fuselage panels that are manufactured from glare, which is a type of glass reinforced aluminium laminate. Finally, we've got the Boeing 787 Dreamliner, an aircraft which really ramped up the use of composite materials, coming in at over 50% of the aircraft. Notice how the presence of aluminium has diminished to 20% for this particular aircraft. And so, in conclusion, you can see that there's been a clear trend towards the use of composites in aircraft manufacture. And so the main question is, what has driven the change? Well, ultimately, it's the demand for efficient aircraft with lower operating costs and the drive towards a more sustainable future. Composite materials, as many of you will know, provide structural strength comparable to metallic materials, but at a lighter weight, which results in lighter aircraft, lower fuel burn, and lower CO2 emissions, which is an important fact to consider given aviation's contribution to global CO2 emissions. Because of this, a lot of progress has been made in automating the production of composite parts, and this is where the processes like automated fibre placement, or AFP, play such an important role in the manufacture of modern aircraft and spacecraft. So that was essentially the preamble to the main subject of this presentation, and at this point, we'll look at the AFP process in a little more detail, followed by a couple of examples of AFP manufacturing cells that I've been working on recently. So what is AFP? Well, in the most basic sense, automated fibre placement involves the deposition of composite material to build a structure one ply or layer at a time, as you can see the machine is doing in the bottom right hand figure in the slide. The AFP process typically places a band of material known as a course, and that's what you can see in the top left diagram. And that course comprises of a number of narrow strips of composite material, and these strips are known as toes. The number of toes in each course can vary depending on the application, but 8 or 16 toes are fairly common. But in practice, it can actually be anything, typically between 1 and 32. The placement of the toes is typically done using an end effector or a head on a motion platform, such as a robot or a gantry type machine. We're looking at a gantry on this particular slide. And control systems allow individual toes to be controlled independently of one another, which means that the toes can be started or stopped at different points along the course, which facilitates a very controllable and repeatable process with minimal waste material. This figure in the slide shows the basic principle of the AFP process for a single toe. The diagram shows multiple plies that you can see just being laid upon the tool. We'll talk more about the tooling later. With the incoming tape coming in from a carbon fibre reel, or creel we call them, and they are normally located somewhere on the head or the robot. So the path of the toe coming in from the top right of the diagram, the tape is fed through the tape roller and the cutting unit, and it's compacted by a compliant roller at the tool point. So that's basically where the compliant roller is pressing down on the toe. Tension is maintained on the toe between the compaction roller and a tensioner that's located further up the robot, in our case on the head. And the motion of the head assembly essentially draws out the tape. If you imagine a bit like a sellotape gun, so the tape isn't so much servo fed, it's just drawn out by the motion of the machine or the robot. Now, as all of that is happening, the heater, which you can see here, at the right-hand side of the figure, is heating the previous layer, which makes the previous layer more tacky so that the toe being laid down can bond to it more effectively. And the idea is that you do this for all of your toes that you want to lay down and repeat the process in different directions depending on your layup requirements. That's the process in its most basic form, and for the sake of this presentation, I'm going to assume that we're looking at a process that uses pre-preg CFRP material. That means the CFRP, which is carbon fibre reinforced plastic, the toes have resin present in the material. And we'll look at the details of that a little bit later on. So looking at the cell, a typical cell, comprises of a robot or a gantry machine with an end effector or a head that's mounted to a rotary axis, which lays tape on some kind of tool or table. In this particular example, we've got the black curved table. And just behind it in the picture, you can see a flat table also. Creels are the spools that you can see on the head. They're like black and yellow in color. And the number of the creels on the head depends on how many toes a particular end effector is feeding. So for an 8-toe head, it would have 8 creels. A 16-toe head would have 16 creels. The picture shows what a 1/4-inch toe creel looks like, and you can see that the toe is mounted to a blue backing film, and that's because the material is impregnated with resin, so you don't want the tape to stick to itself. And so it's necessary to remove the blue backing tape from the toe that you can see during the layup process. Because pre-preg CFRP features a resin in the material, the creels have to be stored in a freezer before use, as the resin in the tape slowly cures over time outside of the freezer. and that reduces its ability to stick to the previous ply that it's been laid on, making it difficult to process. Another reason concerns the post-processing of the parts after layup, as parts composed of pre-preg material have to be processed in an autoclave, which is in effect a big pressure oven. And that is used to limit the porosity in the cured parts. And if the resin has dried, the part won't set in the autoclave, which leads to detrimental effects on the part's structural properties. Because of that, the creels have to be thawed for a few hours before being mounted on the head of the robot, requiring a little bit of planning from a production standpoint. So taking a closer look at the head, this is an example of a 16-toe modular head featuring half-inch toes, and I'll take you through the main features of the head. So on the outer circumference, we have the creels. The dancers or the tensioners are the spools that you can see in black. The spools that take up the backing tape, in this case, the backing tape is actually yellow, and they take up the backing tape off the carbon fibre toes as they're being fed through to the business end. Business end, which reaches the cutting modules, and the feed roller, which feeds the toes to the tool point, which is the compaction roller on the right-hand side, and the heater just above it. In this case, it's an infrared heater. And the root of the tape, so it goes from the creel, goes round the backing tape spool. So as it goes round the backing tape spool, the backing tape spool takes up the backing tape. The tape then goes round the tensioner and then gets fed into the back of the business end. Now, taking a look at the actual business end. So this is the business end with the cutting modules and the passive feed modules and the clamp modules removed, so that you can see more clearly what's going on in here. So here we've got the servoed feed roller. So the servoed feed roller feeds the toes to the tool point or the compaction roller after the toes have been cut. You have the channel guides, which effectively guide the toes to the compaction roller. And you've got the cutting edge, which is this brass looking piece towards the bottom of the picture. And that's where the toes are cut. One thing that's worth pointing out about this kind of design of head is that by having creels mounted directly to the head, the root of each toe from the creel to the tool point is relatively short, and that increases reliability and makes the initial loading of each toe faster and easier. Another advantage is that the removal of the modules, as shown in the slide, requires no use of tooling, and so any cleaning or maintenance operations that need to be done can be done using no tools. You just flip the levers that you can see either side of the head, and the modules simply pull out. So taking a closer look at the robot, now the type of machine or robot that you would use really depends on the payload. For this particular example, I'm looking at the robot. And the payload in our case is the weight of the head. And obviously you have to also consider the size of the part being laid up, because you want to make sure that your machine can reach to all the extremities of the part that you're laying up. In any case, the electro-impact AFP system incorporates the use of an in-house designed infinite axis for the robot tool axis onto which the head is mounted. And that's the picture that you see in the bottom right-hand portion of the slide. So that's it's the cam-shaped assembly there. It has a motor that's pointing out the bottom of it. The head mounts to the yellow bit that you can see pointing out the top. And the motor is coupled to a sprocket, which spins that whole assembly with the yellow cap on it. The electrical and pneumatic feed to the head goes through a slip ring. And so this axis doesn't have limits of travel like a conventional axis. And that's a very useful feature, as it enables you to create more efficient programs and speed up the layup of your part by reducing off-part motion. So if to help visualize this, if you suppose you're laying up close to the limit of an axis, suppose where we've got the head at +5 degrees in the slide, it could be that to rotate the head to your target orientation, suppose our target's +355, you actually need to rotate the head the long way round, 350 degrees to get to your target position due to this dead zone that you can see that you have between your positions, which you would have on a conventional axis. With a continuous axis, this isn't an issue because you can just drive straight to the position, which is 10 degrees rather than 350 degrees. And that saves you a lot of time if you consider how many rotations a head would do on a typical part. So this video shows AFP layup using a robot with a 16-toe head. First thing you'll notice is the heater coming on to heat the previous ply that we're laying down on. You see the white compaction roller that's making contact with the previous ply. That's where we're laying down toes. You can see the creels, the tensioner, and the backing tape spools spinning round as the tape has been drawn out the head. And the white and red tubes you can see are the pneumatic feeds to the cutting modules and the clamp modules of the head. So briefly going back to the continuous axis assembly, another useful feature that I briefly mentioned is that it features a tool changer which enables different heads to be used as part of a modular system. And that means that a single AFP system can use multiple heads, which is advantageous in that you can carry out head maintenance and re-spooling offline, as well as have the capability of laying down different toe widths. The dynamic transfer stands that you see in the picture help facilitate offline activities. Stands enable the heads to be rotated 90 degrees either way by a single button press. And the stand provides electrical and pneumatic power to the head so that the basic functions of the head can be tested, such as the servo feed rollers, the cutting modules, and it enables the business end to be cleaned. So this clip shows what a head swap routine looks like. So if you imagine you're laying up on a part and you run low on material, you need to swap the head. You need to re-spool, and that takes time. So a better way of doing it is by having two heads. You lay down your material, drop the head off in one stand, pick the other head up, and away you go. The clip has been sped up 6 times. The round trip time, you're looking at about 30 seconds to drop off a head, come off the part, drop off a head, and pick the other one up. It's very quick and easy and can be done with the press of the button. This slide shows two types of AFP system that can be used. In the figure on the left, we're looking at a rather large part. I believe this is an A350 fuselage crown. And so this system is utilizing a low rail gantry machine to lay down toes on a curved tool, whereas the figure on the right shows a more flexible cell using a robot with multiple workstations. As you can see, there's a black curved tool. There's a table just behind it, and a rotator to the right-hand side of the robot. Both of these systems have their pros and cons, and it really depends on what the needs of production are, which obviously has to be balanced with cost. Another consideration relates to the width of the toes used for the layup of a particular part, as CFRP toes come in a wide range of widths, typically an eighth to half an inch. And ideally, when laying up a part, you want to use the widest toe possible purely from a cost perspective, because wider toe material is cheaper to purchase due to the fact that there are less slitting operations for a given area of material, which is simple enough for parts with simple geometries, but for more intricate layups, it's sometimes necessary to steer the toes as shown in this slide. When steering is needed for complex parts, you get wrinkles that appear on the internal radius of the curve that you're laying up, as you can see on the bottom section of the steered toes, you can see in the top picture of the slide. The wrinkles get a lot more pronounced when you use a wider toe, and that's where the geometry of your material becomes more of an issue. Best way to visualize it is to think about laying parcel tape onto a piece of card. It's very easy if you lay it down in straight lines, but it soon becomes distorted as soon as you try and lay it down in a curve. The outer edge of the tape is essentially limited by the tension, and the inner curve naturally compresses. So we just go from the parcel tape analogy back to AFP. Using a thinner toe will exhibit less wrinkling, making a narrower toe more suitable when steering is required. Another important consideration for toe width arises from the prevalence of laps and gaps for a part. If you look at the picture on the right-hand side, if you imagine laying up on a double curved surface, like an aircraft nose cone, for example, the wider material will exhibit more pronounced laps and gaps, as the slide shows. Some lapping and gapping is inevitable given the nature of the AFP process, but the level of laps and gaps should be controlled as they interfere with the structural properties of the layup because you've essentially got no fibre there. Again, this can be mitigated to some degree by using a smaller toe width. And if you imagine smaller toe widths being used in this example, the laps and gaps within the part would reduce substantially. So far, we've touched mainly on the laying up of flat parts, but now I'd like to look at cylindrical parts and how the cell can be adapted for layup of, for example, fuselage parts, engine cases, or something of that nature. In these instances, we'd incorporate the use of a rotator and some form of rotating mandrel, depending on the size and shape of the part. For the horizontal rotator, the main parts are the two rotator towers, a master and a slave, which feature a headstock on each side. The headstock's essentially an assembly that the mandrel or tool couples to, and for smaller parts, only the master headstock is driven by a motor, with the slave being passive. For larger, heavier parts, though, the slave is sometimes also driven, and two axes are driven and coupled through the robot controller. Now, we also have vertical rotators, and that's a lot like a horizontal rotator on its side, but without the slave axis. The main assembly in a vertical rotator is a turntable, which is servo-driven, and the part just sits on the turntable with the upper end of the part spinning freely. And we'll see an example of that in one of the case studies I've got. So this is a quick video of a robot laying up on a rotating mandrel on a horizontal rotator. When the robot is laying up on the mandrel, the motion of the robot and the rotator is synchronized through the part program on the robot. And effectively, you have the robot axes and the rotator axes working in tandem. Both the robot and the rotator are controlled by the robot CNC, and all the programs are created and simulated offline, which I'll discuss shortly. What you're seeing in the video now is a snippet of the simulation, and that just enables you to simulate your programs to make sure your programs are doing what you want them to do. And this is a bit of a closer look of how the head lays up on a rotating mandrel. Another important aspect of AFP is toe placement accuracy. You really want to make sure that the toes are being laid down in the right place, which can be challenging when using a robot, as they only offer moderate levels of positional accuracy. The inaccuracies in the robot tool point position arise from the fact that the links of the robot naturally deflect. You get deflections due to the payload, in this case the AFP head. Deflection due to external force inputs, so for us that would be the compaction of the toes as they're being laid down, and backlash in the drivetrain. When it comes to AFP, tool point errors can result in cost-to-cost gaps, overlaps, and toe-end placement errors, and because of this, it's necessary to improve the positional accuracy of the robot. One of the ways you can do this is to mount an optical encoder on the casting of each joint, as shown on the slide. The encoder comprises of an absolute scale and an optical read head. And the signal from the read head is sent to the robot CNC, which is capable of controlling each axis based on the external encoder rather than the primary feedback on the joint servo motor. You can just see the joint servo motor and encoder poking out of the side of the casting on the left in the picture in the slide. The secondary feedback also stiffens the robot in effect, and it allows the CNC to react to positional inaccuracies, whether they have been caused by either static or dynamic forces during path motion. As well as using optical encoders, it's possible to develop a high order kinematic model of the robot, which compensates for how much the tool point deviates due to the deflections I've just mentioned, by calculating what the theoretical toolpoint position of the robot is in any given pose, and then accurately measuring where the toolpoint actually is. Given that we know the geometrical properties of each link of the robot, it's relatively simple to determine the toolpoint in Cartesian coordinates as a function of joint positions, which effectively gives us the nominal position of the toolpoint in XYZ coordinates. If you know the theoretical toolpoint for any combination of joint positions, we can then use a laser tracker to measure the actual position of the toolpoint with a margin of error of approximately 0.05 millimeters, which then gives us the delta between the nominal and actual positions. Now, in practice, you do all this by generating a robot program for a range of different robot poses, and for each pose, you'd have the nominal position in Cartesian coordinates for each toolpoint position. You'd then run the program and you'd measure the toolpoint position in each pose using a laser tracker. Using the nominal and actual toolpoint position data, a solver can then be run to determine the deflection parameters, which enables a kinematic model of the robot to be generated in order to minimize the toolpoint error by effectively compensating for it. This model can be loaded onto the robot CNC, which enables the forward and inverse kinematics of the robot to be executed in real time while automatically predicting for any error. So to visualize this, the diagram in the bottom left-hand portion of the slide shows the position of some holes drilled by a robot without compensation being applied, denoted by the red dots, and those red dots give a 3 sigma positional accuracy of plus or minus 0.45 millimeters. The green dots show the hole positions drilled by an accurate robot with secondary feedback compensation, and they give a 3 sigma error of plus or minus 0.08 millimeters, which is a clear improvement on the standard robot. And so to summarize, clear benefits to using an accurate robot that enables you to maintain path accuracy, especially when you're traversing over a contoured path. And it gives you a better AFP layup and enables the robot to generally lay up faster, thereby increasing productivity. So far, most of what I've talked about refers to the hardware, and at this point, I'd like to touch on the part programming of the robot. So the part program is a file that's read by the robot controller, and it's the part program that drives the machine, specifically the toolpoint, to the positions where you intend to lay up. It also controls various features on the head, such as the heater outputs and the activation of the cutting mechanisms in the business end, as well as a host of many other features. All of those and the toolpoint moves are controlled using G and M codes in the program, so the task of creating a part program from scratch for a complex system like this can be very time consuming and very complicated. And because of this, the offline part programming for the electro-impact AFP system is performed using software called VCP, which has been developed by electro-impact in collaboration with CG Vericut. VCP is a very useful tool for creating programs, as it allows you to read in CAD surface data. So that would be the tool that we're laying up on, as you can see in the top left picture of the slide. And VCP generates the path geometries with linking moves and gives you a part program for use on the robot. At that point, you'd simulate the program using the VCS simulation software, which enables you to detect any potential collisions between the robot and the tool and can verify how the material you're laying down is actually being applied. Another useful feature of simulation in VCS is that it allows you to simulate and configure the pose of the robot at any part of the layup, and the simulation can prove that the robot pose is optimal for the layup of a particular course. The figure you see in the slide in the bottom right picture shows a snapshot of an AFP robot simulation using VCS. And this figure shows what a typical part program on the robot controller would execute. It's literally just lines of text in a file that the robot reads as a program. So to summarize, the VCP and VCS software is very useful. It makes processing and creating of your part programs very efficient, and it enables the user to detect any problems which may occur during the layup before they happen, increasing productivity and reducing the risk of damaging the AFP system or scrapping parts. At this point, I'd like to briefly cover a couple of projects which I've been involved in, which are perfect examples of AFP systems that are used for different purposes. Firstly, I'd like to look at the AFP cell at the National Composites Centre in Bristol, which is a cell comprising of a robotic arm on an X bed that you can see in the middle of the slide, a variable size ATL head, which is the head on the robot, which I'll discuss shortly, a half-inch eight-toe AFP head that you can see in the stand on the right, and just behind that there's an ultrasonic cutting tool and probe head in a static stand. In terms of rotators, on the right-hand side you can see the vertical rotator, and that can cater for tools up to 9 tons in weight with a 4.6 meter diameter, and the vertical rotator that you can see on the left-hand side of the slide just behind the head can cater for parts up to 25 tons and 4.2 meters in diameter. Finally, the layup table you see just behind the robot, you can just about make it out, that facilitates material trials and machine calibration activities, and it provisions for any flat layup activity. There are a couple of additional features within this cell that I haven't really covered in this presentation due to time constraints, which I can quickly summarize, starting with the ATL head. Now, ATL stands for automated tape laying, and the principle of ATL is similar to AFP, only the tape you're laying down is much wider and you're only using one toe at a time. The ATL head is capable of 75, 200 and 300 millimeter tape sizes, and is best suited for large flat geometries with minimal contouring, and it ultimately enables you to get lots of tape down really quickly. It's not suitable for any intricate geometries or any part that might need the tape to be steered due to the sheer width of the tape used, but for laying up simple parts quickly, it's ideal. Furthermore, the ATL head can also be used to lay up specialty base layers by applying fiberglass or expanded copper foil layers to the lamina. Talking briefly about the ultrasonic cutter, that's used for trimming operations, and it allows a part that's been laid up to be trimmed to the exact shape that you want it to be, and that's shown in the left-hand picture. The right-hand picture shows the probe head, and that uses the same assembly as the ultrasonic cutting head. And it's primarily used for locating parts, namely the layup tool for the AFP machine, as you want your toes to be placed in the correct location on the tool. So the robot needs to accurately know where the tool is. So as you can see, this is an example of a flexible cell with multiple work zones and can cater for the layup of many different types of parts, lending itself well to R&D and pre-production activities. Taking a look at the cell at the European Space Agency in Madrid, this cell is used to lay up parts for the Ariane 6 space rocket, which I've shown in the picture on the left-hand side of the slide. Ariane 6 is an unmanned rocket which is to be used to carry a range of payloads, in this case satellites, to a wide range of orbits depending on the application, such as Earth observation, telecommunications and navigation. Taking a look at the actual parts, we've got the launch vehicle adapter, which works as an interface between the spacecraft and the launch vehicle. It's a physical structure which connects the payload to the launch vehicle. Next, we've got the interface structure, which is part of the main rocket structure between the upper and lower stages of the rocket, and I believe it houses the upper propulsion module. Finally, you've got the equipped solid rocket structure, which is a part of the, especially the upper part of the rocket solid boosters. Now, I've just shown what we call dumb models here, because I'm not actually allowed to show you the actual models from an IP perspective, but it gives you an idea of the shape of the parts that we're trying to lay up. Taking a closer look at the cell, it consists of two robots, robot one working between rotators one and two, and robot two working on rotator three. The general idea is that you have a rotator for each part, but the production tools from the parts can be mounted into any of the rotators, which gives a degree of flexibility from a production planning standpoint. The robot one CNC controls both rotators one and two, and the robot two CNC controls rotator three. One of the key differences within this cell is that the rotator clamping is fully automated, in that both the master and slave tower axes have servo motors enabling the rotator to clamp to the part with the push of a button. Typically, the master tower of a rotator is moved to a reference position using a hand wheel, and it's fixed in position using a locating pin, and it's often done by hand. Now, that's not an issue when you're mounting smaller tools, but for heavier tools and for heavier parts can be very cumbersome and less safe. And in this case, the process of loading one of the tools is done as follows. So you have an AGV, which is an automated guided vehicle, comes into the station with the tool, and it's positioned in such a way that the rotary axis of the tool is roughly aligned with the rotary axis of the rotator. The operator pushes a button to initiate the clamping routine, and then both towers move into clamping on the tool using probe-type sensors, and the towers clamp to the tool using a force-sense function on the tower servo motors. Once clamped, the AGV is removed from the cell, and the two towers are then moved in tandem to the build position, which is set by the position of the master tower axis, resulting in a quick, safe clamping procedure. In terms of the heads, there are three 16 spool heads which are located in dynamic stands, which enables them to be re-spooled offline, and a layup table used for head testing. The cell also features more in the way of ancillary equipment, such as the platforms you can see, the yellow platforms, which are used for inspection, and these are generally moved around the cell with master movers that are like powered trolley jacks for moving heavy loads. So as you can see, this is a good example of a dedicated cell for an industrial application. And as you can appreciate, there's a lot to be considered from really a health and safety perspective. But to go into that at this point would be beyond the scope of this presentation and would, in all seriousness, be a separate presentation in itself. Just before I end, I'd like to emphasize that what you've seen today is a brief overview of what a typical AFP process looks like, and there is lots of development work happening continually in the world of AFP, especially at Electro Impact. All of these developments aim to improve the AFP process from a productivity standpoint by increasing the layup time as a percentage of total cell time, which is usually lost due to part inspection, tool moves, and reliability recovery. Some of the latest innovations that have occurred since the National Composites Centre and European Space Agency cells were installed include some of the following: the modular servo creel, AFP head, and a new modular head PLC, which yields better AFP process reliability and better toe end placement accuracy, among a host of other advantages. There's the development of the variable spot size laser, the VSS laser, which is a new type of heat source, enabling higher temperatures to be achieved for higher layup speeds and better adhesion between plies. The laser enables the precise control and placement of heat, which isn't something that you can easily do with conventional infrared heating technology. We have the rapid in-process inspection technology, or RIPIT, which is a system that completes in-process inspection of toe end placement, laps and gaps, and a host of other features. And that enables complete parts to be built with no operator intervention or manual inspection. So these are just some of the examples which feed into the AFP 4.0 philosophy, the idea of which is to drastically increase the utilization of our AFP equipment by reducing manual intervention, rework and inspection, and speeding up the lamination process and improving the quality of laminations. For those of you that might want to read into a bit more of all this, feel free to visit our website. It sounds like a bit of a shameless plug, but it really is quite interesting to read up on, www.electroimpact.com. And there you can find a lot of useful information on our latest developments, including white papers, video, and various other resources. If anyone wants to inquire about anything that you've heard, don't hesitate to contact me. My details will be forwarded onto you upon request. And that brings me to the end of this presentation. So thank you very much for listening, and I'll do my very best to answer any questions that you may have on what I've presented today. Thank you very much.
Hi, John. Many thanks for the interesting presentation. I have to admit I didn't quite appreciate how much technology goes into making this automatic fiber placement. We have quite a few questions which came in through from the attendee questions, and we're going to try and answer them in an order which makes sense. I hope we'll get around to answer most of them, but I can't promise because we have a bit of limited time. Can I start with the first question on how reliable...
Yeah, can you hear me fine?
Yes, I can hear you.
Sorry, great. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, on how reliable the system is and what the typical issues are when you get when you start using the AFP system in production.
Yeah, so that's a good question. So generally speaking, the AFP process is very reliable indeed. And I guess it makes sense if you think about how the process works purely from a mechanical point of view. So if you consider an AFP machine in comparison to, say, I don't know, a drilling robot, a packaging machine, the kind of things that you see in industry, the AFP system isn't really subjected to much in terms of, you know, external forces, excessive vibration, chemicals, that kind of thing. You know, they're not really under much duress, so to speak. You know, you've got a huge robot that's drawing out thin strips of material, so there isn't really that much that can go wrong. That said, you know, there are a few caveats that arise, and this is driven more from a, I guess, a process perspective rather than the design of the system hardware. So what you saw in the presentation was to do with the processing of prepreg CFRP. Now, when it comes to laying down prepregs, one of the biggest problems is that the resin from the tape builds up after time, specifically in the business end of the head. So that's where all the clamp modules, cutting modules, and the feed modules are. And over time, if that's not managed, it can cause the tape to be misfed, miscut, and you can get wraparounds on the feed rollers and the kind of intricate parts in the business end, if you like. Build-up typically occurs on, you know, things like the toe shoots, and they're essentially like the narrow slits that the tape feeds through, and you get build-up on the roller and the cutting knives. But all of that can be dealt with by having a rigorous like a maintenance process in place, if you like, and having a good cleaning regime when it comes to re-spooling the head. So each time you come off the part, you'd literally just give the innards of the business end a good clean before re-spooling and going back on. And the business end, as you saw when we looked at it in the slide, is designed to be cleaned without the use of tooling, and it doesn't take long to do. But if that process isn't maintained, then that build-up will just build up over time, and you'll get problems similar to what I've just mentioned. You can also get things like wraparounds, so that's where the toe sticks to the compaction roller rather than sticking to the substrate layer that you're laying up on. And that can be caused by things like poor heat control. The compaction roller gets hot and the toes stick to the roller instead of the substrate layer. Again, that's more of a process driven thing, and that tends to happen, you know, when you have poor process control with your heating. So yeah, that's kind of the long and short of it. I know that an example actually that I was given that I'm able to quote is that Middle River Aviation in Baltimore, one of the most productive AFP systems in the world, and they have next to zero defects. And that is, a lot of that is down to the fact that they have a very religious approach in terms of implementing maintenance operations, such as cleaning the head after re-spool and carrying out planned preventative maintenance schedules when they should be done. So you could really argue that a lot of the reliability is more down to the process than the actual hardware itself.
Okay. Thanks a lot for that answer, John. And we've got quite a lot of questions to go through. So if I do mind if I continue, the next question was whether a test panel is made at the same time to check the properties of the manufactured part.
Sorry, could you just repeat that? Let me just test piece of the manufactured part. Yes, so we do. So we tend to lay up a small strip, about 150 mil by 150 millimeters, and we lay that up for each batch of material from the head. Now that gets put into an autoclave and cured with the part, and the reason for that is for traceability more than anything else. It's more of a quality initiative. We also occasionally do toe tuning, so you lay up a course of material and you look at how the toes have been laid, the placement of those toes. It gives you an idea of the timing of when the toes are actually cut when you draw them out of the head. And we can tune the system to improve that toe tuning. So if you've got some toes that have been cut slightly shorter, for example, that gives you a means to do that. But a lot of that is customer dependent. But I think we tend to mainly do that with each head change, material change, or a consumable change. So if we change something in the head, then we kind of need to make sure that our process is still good after changing a pretty significant variable in the process, if you like. So we tend to do test pieces and for all manner of different reasons, really.
Okay, good. Thanks a lot. We've got two more questions, I think, to the manufacturing. One question is whether for composite fuselages, a full barrel, like in the Boeing 787, is better, or whether a composite panel similar to the Airbus 350 would be easier to manufacture.
That's an interesting question. So for composite fuselage, it's a full barrel. Yeah, I mean, it depends. I mean, you have the capability to do anything, really. It's always going to be easier to do composite panels, but full barrels, yeah, while it presents its challenges, it's you can literally do whatever you want, to be honest. I don't really fully understand the question, if I'm being completely honest with you, but, you know, we lay up fuselages and we lay up wing panels, so both are going to present their challenges okay. Yeah, completely. You know, it all depends. It's a very difficult question to answer, to be honest, because I think it, you know, with a lot of these things, with AFP, a lot of it is all about the part that you're laying up. You know, no two fuselages are going to be the same. No two wing panels are going to be the same. So, you know, you're really going to, you really have to take it on a case-by-case basis. And that's what we do at Electro Impact. You know, a customer presents us with the part and then we do what we can. You know, obviously, we have the CAD data for that. We can simulate layups. We use the VCP to create programs, VCS to simulate them. And obviously, you know, they kind of allow you to see what, you know, to give you a good representation of your process before you actually put a robot on a part. There are kind of lots of different ways you can look at these things, and it's all very much part dependent.
Okay, good. Thank you. We've got another question which talks about the general manufacturer, which actually goes in the opposite direction, whether there are any minimum size limitations you could do with this kind of machinery, or whether there are smaller sizes which would be more suitable for small and complex geometries.
Sorry, could you just repeat that question? I've not seen that one come up.
It's a question about the minimum size. So whether there's a minimum size limitation, what you could do with the automatic fiber placement, or whether there's smaller sizes, I believe, from the head available for small and complex geometries?
Yeah, so again, a lot of that is driven by the part. I think a lot of what we've seen in the presentation relates to the layup of huge parts. It all depends, again, on how small a part, you know, you're looking at. And I think a big thing that you also have to consider with AFP is is the payback on it, because obviously AFP equipment is very expensive. And if you're just laying up one or two small parts with very thin tow, you could argue that, you know, doing it by hand would be a better use of your time and money than using something, you know, like what we've seen in the presentation. It is possible, yes, but again, there will be limits. It depends how small you're talking, really. And, you know, you do have to consider the financial aspect of having an AFP system, because it's, you know, it's capital and it's space intensive.
Okay, thank you.
I hope that answers that question.
Yeah, I guess it depends on the application. We've sure. now got a couple of questions specifically on the layup of the carbon structure. Mm-hmm. And maybe if we start with a question, which is why you are not weaving the carbon fiber toes, but placing them down with adjacent toes in the same direction. Would that be possible?
I think it's fair to say that anything is possible, but I guess there's kind of a reason, and we've got to look at the main benefit of AFP, really. So obviously, like, AFP is an additive process. So you're laying up on a ply by ply level, and the whole point of AFP is that it gives you the ability to lay up fibers in the directions that you actually want them to suit the structural requirements of the part that you want to produce. And I guess that's the whole point of AFP. You're essentially optimizing the part through fiber orientation, because it's the fiber orientation that gives you the strength in that part. And the whole point of AFP is that you have total control over that. Now, if you weave, you have less flexibility with the fiber orientation. It's literally threaded in and out of the matrix, and, you know, the fabric doesn't really give you the option of putting the fibers where you want them, if that makes sense. And on top of that, you know, it would be more difficult to process, as I guess you'd have to produce lots of woven fabric and then lay them up all in different orientations. Now, to automate that would be pretty tricky. You'd have to lay up fabric one on top of another, layer by layer, and you'd literally have no chance when it came to, you know, steering and that kind of thing. You know, a weaving machine would be kind of a lot more complex. You'd have a lot more moving parts and that kind of thing. So you'd, in the end, you'd have a complex machine without, you know, having the core benefits on offer with AFP, and that is to have complete control over fiber orientation. So that's really the crux of it. But that said, you know, woven fabric definitely has its place, you know, for certainly smaller parts and for parts that aren't subjected to the kind of loadings where, you know, you really need to think about fiber orientation. So, you know, it does lend itself very nicely to smaller parts. And, you know, you look at, I don't know, car parts and that kind of thing. And, you know, woven material does look pretty cool too. So I think some of it comes down to that as well. Again, you know, it's all on what you're using the material for. But that really, it's the whole having control over the orientation of your toes is the main reason why we do it like we do it and we don't weave.
Okay, thanks a lot. I think that answered that question. We have a few more follow-up questions on the ply layup. The next mm-hmm. question would be whether there are any specific ply layup rules to be followed, which would work better for the automated fiber placement.
Yeah, that's a good question. I think really the key rule is what I've just mentioned in terms of orienting the fibers, but it's a very interesting question that's raised, because part of the presentation focused on the prevalence of laps and gaps. So that is where you get basically gaps when you lay up on things like double curved surfaces and that kind of thing. And there are certain rules that you have to follow when dealing with that. So just to quickly go into laps and gaps, obviously you're going to get them. It's inevitable as part of the AFP process. And there's little things that you can do to limit how much lapping and gapping that you get on a particular layup. Now, as we said in the presentation, you know, you can make laps and gaps less prevalent by using narrower toe, but even then you're still going to get them to some degree. And the problem with that is everywhere you get a lap and specifically a gap, you don't have fiber there. So that has implications on the structural integrity of your part. Now, one of the ways that you can deal with that is by planning the layup of your part. And this is where the VCP and VCS Vericut, the programming and the simulation software, are particularly advantageous, because you can simulate where those laps and gaps are. And by doing that, you can distribute the laps and gaps to areas in your part that don't have high stress concentrations. Now, that's a very iterative process. You know, the idea is that you'd model your part, say, in finite element analysis software. You'd see where your stresses are, and then you would ensure that your laps and gaps stay away from those areas of high stress concentrations. And aerospace manufacturers do have certain rules. Now, I couldn't tell you exactly what those rules are. It'll be things like how much lapping and gapping you can have per ply, for example, you know, the magnitude of those laps and gaps and that sort of thing. And you'll find that, you know, different aerospace manufacturers will have different rules. So while there are rules, it's the rules are made up by different people, and the rules differ wherever you go. You know, this whole thing is an iterative process. It's a collaborative process between, you know, your programmer, your stress engineer. And it's something that, you know, people generally have, you know, can have quite differing opinions on. So yeah, rules do exist, but the rules kind of do change a little bit depending on who you talk to.
Okay, thank you. Just a quick follow-up question on that. You mentioned you need to avoid wrinkles when you curve the toes. Is there actually mm-hmm. any guidance on the degree of curvature versus the toe width which you can use?
Yes. So again, a lot of this comes down to just testing and a little bit of, a lot of this is process driven, really. So steering toe, it depends on two things primarily: your toe width, because as we covered in the presentation, toes come in different widths. And you've also got to consider the radius of the steered path. So those are kind of your two variables, really, that you need to focus on. And they're not really governed by a strict set of rules, but there are some guidelines based on some of the testing that we've done in the past. And again, different manufacturers might have slightly different data on this. But we found that we can comfortably steer with half inch material. But the minimum radius of your steer path really depends on what you're laying down on. So things like the shape of the tool. Again, with AFP, a lot of it comes down to what you're actually producing, you know, the mold that you're laying up on and that kind of thing. But primarily from a process perspective, it's your heating method and your compaction forces that really kind of influence whether you can steer successfully or not. We call like momentary steering, so that's when you're doing short, sharp arcs, is much easier than continuous steering. So to give you an idea, I think the biggest toe that we can steer with, and I might be corrected on this, but I know that we've had a lot of success with half inch toe with a minimum radius of around, I think, 36 inches, which is just less than a meter. But that's using quite advanced heating technologies. So that's using a laser heater rather than an infrared heater. And that's a whole other subject in itself. You know, we can even go to smaller radii for smaller arc lengths. So the 36 inch, I think, is for continuous steering. And I think we can get down to about 26 inches for smaller arc lengths. Whereas for comparison, using an infrared heater, you know, we're looking at around 150 inches, which is nearly 4 meters. This is all for pre-preg, so I'm not really, I could get you the data, I'm not really sure what we're looking at for thermoplastics and things like that. So generally, the things that make steering worse is laying up on things like concave geometries, poor heating, so, you know, your laser heating, because you can control the heating and get it down quicker. You know, that improves matters, and, you know, the thickness of the material comes into play as well. So yeah, things like tool point velocity, high heat, high compaction, they're kind of the main things that really influence how good your steered toe actually is. And as a separate note, sorry, I'm waffling maybe a little bit here, but as a separate note, there is actually a article on Composites World that's looking at toe steering, looking to optimize wing design, because they think that the next generation of wings for commercial aircraft are going to be more high aspect ratio, that's long and narrow wings, for improved fuel efficiency and that kind of thing. Those wings would have a tendency to flop around a lot more, and they're looking at ways that they could use toe steering to mitigate that. So if anyone's bored this afternoon, that's it's quite an interesting read for sure.
Okay, thanks, John. I just got the hurry up sign, so we only have
fine.
A few minutes left, because I think we're about out of time. So if I can just try and race you through a few more questions. In terms of layup rates, is there a comparison you can do against manual layup?
Oh gosh. Right. Interesting. So layup rates is an interesting one when you consider AFP, because your layup rate, again, and I'm going to sound like a broken record here, really depends on the part that you're laying up. You know, I can give you our maximum layup rate, but it's very misleading. I think we quote that we can do up to 4,000 inches per minute, which is 100 meters a minute. But in the real world, you're never going to get that. That would be a very flat, very simple geometry part. And you're never going to achieve that in a million years on something like, say, a fuselage that is curved and somewhere where you have complex geometries. So it's very, very difficult to really give a solid answer on layup rates, because, again, it's all down to that. You know, we can do up to 4,000, but in the real world, you're never going to get that. Layup rates for, oh, gosh, hand layups, I can't remember. I think hand layup rates, do they quote something like 2-3 pounds of material per hour or something? That's just a figure that I've literally plucked out of my head. It might be completely wrong. But in short, you know, AFP, for bigger, flat, well, again, it depends what you're laying up by hand, you see, because when you're laying up things by hand, they tend to be more complex parts in quite small molds. If you imagine, I don't know, a wing panel for a Formula One car or something, there's no way you could really automate that, because getting a head, an AFP head, into a mold that is that small, you know, you're never going to be able to do that. So it just comes down to what it is that you're actually laying up. And I'll be honest, in terms of layup rates by hand, I couldn't give you a figure as to what layup rates you're going to get by hand.
That is perfectly fine. And changing the topic a little bit, we had a question whether the advances with AFP you mentioned, whether they will be able to eliminate manual inspection completely.
That is certainly the aim, and that is what we would like to do, and we're certainly on the right path. Whether we would eliminate completely, there's always going to be some human element to it. But obviously, with the latest generation of AFP heads, you know, we're looking to eliminate that certainly on a ply-to-ply basis, because right now the problem with AFP is that utilization rates of AFP robots tend to be very, very low, certainly in a traditional cell. I mean, you're looking at, you're probably looking at about 20% robot utilization for a traditional cell. I think for something slightly newer with optimized layup, you're looking at 40%, but that's still quite a lot of time you're looking at for, you know, for the robot that's essentially sitting around doing nothing. We're certainly looking to get it to below 10%, and I think that's definitely achievable. When you look at things like, again, with the rip-it system that I mentioned in the last slide, it's essentially taking out the human element of inspection on a ply-by-ply basis, because that's what you find in an AFP cell. You lay up a ply, then you're pulling over the robot, and then you have people that inspect all the toes, toe placement, things like foreign object debris on the ply, things like if you have any puckering or anything like that on the toes, you know, that all has to be sorted out. And if you find anything, you have to correct it. And all of this stuff takes an awful lot of time. And the whole rip-it system looks to pretty much eliminate that. And of course, you know, making the head more reliable so that you don't get those problems in the first place. And things like optimizing like heating technology now with lasers and that kind of thing, you can control the heat more, you can direct it more precisely. And that enables you to ultimately lay down more quickly, really. So yeah, we certainly, that's certainly what we're aiming for. We've made an awful lot of progress with that. And it's definitely worth reading up on if you get a moment. We've got some good white papers on that kind of thing, so.
Okay, thank you. I'll try and raise you through a few more questions. We've got two technical questions just about the manufacture. The first one is, how do you remove the mandrels once you have finished the part?
How do we remove the mandrels? This is an interesting question. So I believe... that the problem is that I've not really seen parts kind of going to autoclaves and that kind of thing. We've just been concerned mainly with the layup, but I believe the mandrel goes in to the autoclave with the layup, and then you cure the part and you essentially just pull it off the mandrel. It depends on the design of the mandrel and that kind of thing, and the thing that you're actually laying up. I can get you a more accurate answer on that. The honest answer is I'm not entirely sure from that, because that's more of a post-processing point of view, and that's not something that I have really spent a lot of time on. I've had a lot of exposure to, I'll be completely honest.
Okay. That is perfectly fine. And we've got another question regarding the RIPIT program and the measurement in process. And the question is whether such a system can be retrofitted into other machines.
I believe it can be retrofitted to a degree, yes. I mean, if you're looking at, you know, a different manufacturer and that kind of thing, it would be very, very tricky to do that and probably very costly. If it was, say, an older generation of electro-impact head, yes, it is possible. You know, the best thing to do would be to just get in touch and see what we can do, because it is possible, but you kind of have to, you know, weigh up how much it costs and that kind of thing, because, you know, that can be quite costly, and you have to decide whether, you know, the payback, certainly by eliminating inspection, you know, the payback would probably be actually okay to retrofit that kind of a system. But again, you know, I would implore you to get in touch, because it depends on what your system is, you know, what the machine is, and whether it would be worth it or not.
Okay, thank you. I've got three more questions for you, and I think then I really need to bring this to a close.
Yes,
and we've got
okay.
a question, to what extent the UK is a leader in terms of making or using these machines for automatic fiber placement and composite manufacture?
Are you talking from purely using the machine or actually manufacturing the machine? So could you just repeat that question once more? Sorry.
I think the question is, to what extent is the UK a leader in terms of making the machine? So I assume manufacturing the machine, or in actually using them, so for manufacturing parts?
I wouldn't describe the UK as being necessarily a leader, but we're certainly making great strides in the manufacture and use of AFP machines. Now, Electro Impact is an American company. They're based in Seattle. But fortunately for us, we have made great inroads into getting some of our machines into Europe. And it's been an overwhelmingly positive experience. You know, we're getting a lot of expertise now, and we're learning an awful lot about these machines. And, you know, it's kind of getting to the point where, you know, the UK can effectively manufacture these machines, and we've got the expertise to do that. So yeah, we're certainly on our way. I wouldn't say we're a world leader, but the more investment there is in AFP, and the more we can get it, you know, into domestic markets and into Europe, then yeah, you know, that expertise will increase. There are certain things that, like with our heads and stuff, there are things like export license issues and that kind of thing, and that's a very boring topic of conversation for another day. So there's only so much that we can do on this side of the water with the heads and that kind of thing. But in terms of understanding the process and from a manufacturing perspective, using the machines, and not only that, you know, understanding the actual process and gaining expertise in the process and the materials that we use in that process, you know, we're doing really, really well. There's work to be done, though. There's work to be done, and but I'm sure that we will get there.
Okay, good. I've got two more technical questions for you, if you can bear with us. One question is for the ultrasonic cutting system. What is the blade life limited by, and is the blade changing facilitated by the automated process?
Okay, so in terms of the blade life, I would have to get back to you on that. I don't really know what the blade life is. I think it does last a long time, though, and it's very, very easy to change. We don't really change the blade in an automated process. So, for example, I think we saw in the NCC, you have a separate ultrasonic head. So the idea is that after laying up your part, you then drop off your AFP head that you've been laying up with, and then you'd pick up the ultrasonic cutting head and profile your part that way. So the ultrasonic cutter, the head is a modular design, and you literally just drop off one head, pick up the other, run your cutting operation, and that's it, and you're done. So yeah, in terms of blade life, not entirely sure. I'd have to get back to you on that, because I don't know a lot in terms of the intricacies of the ultrasonic cutting process. But yeah, that's kind of how we do it from a process point of view.
That is fine. I've got one last technical question for you, which comes back to the curing. The question is why you need to heat cure the part in an autoclave when you're already applying heat while laying down the composite fiber.
Okay, so there's two things that go on in an autoclave. Firstly, you've got temperature, and you've also got pressure as well. An autoclave is like a big pressure oven. So for prepreg materials, when we're laying them up, yes, we're applying heat, but we're really not applying that much heat at all. And the reason we are applying that heat is that it gives us adhesion. So you're heating up the substrate layer so that you're basically increasing the tackiness of that substrate layer, and you're literally sticking your incoming toes onto that substrate layer. But that's not really curing the part as such, you're just increasing the adhesion. So the idea is that you put the whole layup in the autoclave, and the idea of the autoclave is that the resin sets, and it essentially limits the porosity in the part. That's the main aim, really, of the autoclave, because by its very nature, CFRP is porous, and in sticking it in an autoclave, you're essentially curing it, and you're essentially eliminating that porosity. And you also have to consider the laps and gaps and things like that, and the resin making its way into those areas as well, which you're never going to do with the heater as you're laying up on the part, because it's just nowhere near hot enough. And, you know, it's beyond the scope of heating on the part while you're laying up as well.
Okay, good. Thank you for that. I'm afraid for the audience, I know we haven't managed to answer all of the questions, but I think we've run quite a bit over time now. So I would like to thank John again for the very interesting presentation and bearing with us, answering all of the questions or most of the questions we could get through. And I'm sure if you get in touch with any more technical questions, John will be very happy to try and answer these to you. And I think he's pointed you to a couple of other points. So, John, very thanks for the interesting presentation.
Yeah, no worries. And thanks to everybody for listening. And again, you know, my details are available on request. So just get in touch and they'll put you through to me. And obviously, there's our website as well, www.electroimpact.com.
Thank you, John. And thanks for bearing with us, even though we ran a bit over time.
No worries.